Welcome back, everyone. In this video, we're going to upgrade the LED lighting controls in our Overland Expedition truck using WLED, a couple of these RGB-LED controllers, and the overqualified AN Penta Plus, a high-performance LED controller that I should have probably installed years ago if I'd known any better, finally replacing something I cobbled together in a Mexican roadside taco stand during lockdown. When I originally built our Overland truck and fitted it with interior LED lights, I didn't mess around. I went straight for high quality, densely populated, color accurate, 5000 Kelvin white LED strips. These aren't your average decorative flashy fairy lights. These are high grade, burn your retina task lighting. When we give people a tour of our truck, they inevitably ask if it feels dark or gloomy in here without any windows. And that's when I turn up the power, and then they're squinting like they've just opened the Ark of the Covenant. In the beginning, I went with a quick and dirty control solution. I used a simple, off-the-shelf LED lighting controller with a volume-style brightness knob. It worked, but it didn't offer the kind of sophistication and automation I was looking for. Bit of a side story, that volume dial came out of retirement when our truck's accelerator pedal died in rural Colombia. I repurposed it along with a 3D printed curved rack and pinion gear train that we needed to generate the throttle position and idle validation signals that the engine computer needed to drive our truck out of a tough spot. But anyway, I tried to improve our lighting controls during the pandemic lockdown in Mexico. I designed and built what would eventually be infamously dubbed the Todd boards. These were 8-channel, MOSFET-driven boards, powered by an ESP8266. This allowed me to retire the original volume knob LED dimmer, and then I just used Blink to tie everything together, finally achieving the level of control and automation I'd been craving. Half a decade and 15 countries later, I have to admit defeat. They're not ideal, because in an RV or automotive environment, most systems are negatively grounded and then switched positive. So that's what I built. Unfortunately, that design choice makes my controllers fundamentally flawed for dimming LEDs. Thanks to the P-channel MOSFETs that I used, they have a somewhat high on resistance, combined with a limited PWM frequency of an 8266, and the result is a lighting experience best described as functional. The brightness levels stutter, transitions are anything but smooth, and the lowest brightness setting is still too bright. On top of that, the PWM switching frequency is slow enough to produce visible banding on camera, as seen in this exaggerated example. Worse than that, it creates a low-level buzzing that only noise-canceling headphones and our wireless microphones seem to appreciate. No matter how much I tweaked it, I just couldn't get the lights to dim on gracefully. It felt less like dimming the lights and more like tossing a flashbang. The second part of this LED light project was inspired by our last trip back to Canada to visit family. On the overnight flight, I found myself surprisingly soothed by the airplane's ambient lighting. Those alternating warm and cool tones made everything feel just a little bit more luxurious. Back before we became professional homeless people, we actually had a home back in Canada, and it was automated to the hilt. Occupancy sensors, automated lights, colored LED light strips throughout the house, voice controls, mood presets, the whole nerdy dream. And to be honest, I kind of missed that vibe in our otherwise sterile white camper interior. And sure, I could just slap in some basic LED strips that all glow the same color, but that feels so 2001. These days, we have individually addressable LEDs, where every LED light on that strip can do its own thing. Because if it's worth doing, it's worth overdoing. And while I won't be turning our truck into a rave cave with technicolor rainbows and seizure-inducing strobe effects, it's nice to have the option to use those color LEDs for something a little extra while still being refined. Like fireworks as a transition when the white LEDs come on, or color temperature shifts that are choreographed to time of day. For example, I can warm up the lighting in the evening to cut down on our blue light exposure before going to bed. And then in the morning, we can schedule a gentle sunrise effect that sweeps across the room, starting with a dull red glow that blossoms into oranges, burnt umbers, and warm yellows before finally settling into a cheerful sunny morning. It's a far more civilized way to wake up than fumbling out of bed half asleep and then blasting yourself in the face with full force interrogation lighting. So on that same trip back to Canada, I ordered a couple rolls of those WS2812 LEDs on a 6mm wide strip so they'd fit inside our existing LED extrusions and share the same diffuser as our white task lighting. In my initial testing, I just used a ESP8266 and flashed it with the WLED web installer. Just plug in the USB cable, visit the website, click install, and that's it. It's incredibly easy, works out of the gate, creating an access point for you to join with your phone, and then letting you enter your Wi-Fi credentials for your main Wi-Fi if you'd like. Within minutes, you're controlling lights and exploring dozens of mesmerizing lighting effects. Unfortunately, once I hooked up all four separate strings of these LEDs, stability issues started cropping up. The controller would crash or glitch randomly, the LEDs would flicker chaotically, and I couldn't quite figure out why. Switching to an ESP32 helped a lot with stability, but the LED glitching still lurked in the shadows. To complicate things, I have lighting on both sides of the camper, and that meant running 12 volts for the LEDs and a separate 5 volts for the controller to each side. Of course, I could step the 12 volts down to 5 volts and 3D print some kind of case. But then I stumbled across these turnkey controllers on Amazon for $30. They have everything built in. The power filtering, a decent enclosure, spring terminals, even have a microphone for audio reactive effects, and it has WLED pre-installed to save you the 11 seconds of time it'll take to flash it yourself. I'll put a link to these in the description if you're interested. Unfortunately, even with these, I still saw the same weird glitching in the LED patterns. So then I blamed electromagnetic interference from the PWM powering the white LED strips that share the same aluminum extrusion. But then I made an interesting discovery. When I disconnected the data line from one strip, but left the power connected, the amputated strip was still mimicking the LED patterns from the one that I left connected. The data wires were acting as antenna, transmitting and receiving interference from each other. Even with only a half a meter of parallel wire run, it was enough for them to talk over each other and cause chaos. Once I realized the issue, the solution was obvious. I just needed shielded twisted pair. Unfortunately, tracking down specialty wiring while overlanding through foreign lands isn't always so easy. I tried a few local shops, but all I could find was basic wiring. And then it hit me. A cheap 10-foot HDMI cable from the local hardware store is full of twisted pair. I picked one up for about $5, sliced it open, and harvested the twisted pairs I needed. I ended up using a twisted triple and grounded the shielding and two of the three conductors at the controller. Instantly, everything started working properly. This kind of interference probably wouldn't be a big issue in a spacious home setup where you have all the room in the world to run your wires, but in a compact camper packed with angry pixies, it made all the difference. And then, just when I thought I had it all sorted, this LED strip started acting up, glitching out and failing right here. One LED refused to pass the rest of the signal down the line, and so I ended up needing to peel this open, and I poked and prodded at it a bit, and it would come back to life briefly. So I ended up performing a little bit of open strip surgery and spliced in a new segment right there in the middle. With all the glitching and weirdness finally sorted, let's move on to final installation, and I'll show you how I'm hooking everything up and how I'll program them. These little white GLED opto controllers are really straightforward. All you need to do is provide either 12 or 24 volts, depending on your LED light strip voltage. In my case, it's all 12 volts, and you can connect the power to the controller using either these spring terminals or with a 5.5 millimeter barrel jack. On the output side, there are two sets of spring terminals, perfect for controlling two separate LED strips. I've split mine between the top and bottom lights in these extrusions. You can wire them in parallel, but then both strips are always going to display the same thing. So I feel this is a little more dynamic and a little more fun with the effects. Alright, so for a quick setup demonstration, I've wired up these two strips of LEDs and powered everything up. Next, get out your phone and look at your Wi-Fi settings. You'll see there's the WLED access point, and you can connect to that, and that will allow you to set up your Wi-Fi for your home network or whichever Wi-Fi you want to connect to. So once it connects, it wants you to sign into the network, sign in, and then there's the Welcome to WLED screen. You can click on Wi-Fi settings, and I will enter my Wi-Fi credentials. Once you've entered everything, click Save and Connect, and the unit is going to reboot and join your home Wi-Fi network. And once you join your home Wi-Fi network again, you can open the WLED app, as I've done here, and add a device with the checkmark symbol, and then click Discover Lights. And as you can see, I've got a new controller here now listed at the bottom. I'll click on that, go into configuration settings, and I'll change the name to table LEDs. Next, I'll set up which pins the LED strings are connected to. Just click on LED preferences. On these controllers, I know it's data pin 16 and 2. So with those pins set, click save, and we should be ready to try this out. Choose a color palette and an effect, and voila, Technicolor rainbows. Now, when you're wiring these things up, sure, you could just strip the end of the wire and jam it in there. But if you've ever dealt with spring lever terminals, you'll know that after a few insertions and removals, the wire strands start to fray, and eventually one rogue strand might short out against the terminal next to it. That's why I highly recommend picking up one of these wire ferrule kits with a crimping tool. They make inserting multi-stranded wires much easier and reduce the risk of fray strands causing you problems. Plus, they're great for really fine wires that aren't stiff enough to push into spring terminals on their own. Ferrules bulk them up just enough to make everything feel clean, solid, and you'll look like you vaguely know what you're doing. Since we have two LED strips on the right side of the vehicle and two more on the left, and considering the signal integrity issues we discussed earlier, I've decided to keep things easy on myself and just use two wireless controllers for the colored LEDs. As you can plainly see, I already have the strips and the controller wired up here on the right side of the vehicle. It's mounted up in here and behind my anti-death machine, and I wanted it mounted as close as possible to the origin of the LED strips just to prevent any interference on long lengths of data line. And the left side of the vehicle, we're going to mount in here, in behind my dinette cushion where the 3D printer lives. And I'm mostly doing that to, again, keep the data lines as short as possible to prevent any interference, and because of the obvious ease of access. So that's the colored LEDs all wired up and installed. Time for a quick test. Unfortunately, this camera doesn't pick up the colors very well. It gets all noisy. So we'll switch over to my phone camera here. Check out the reds, green, blue. Looking good. How about some fireworks? Oh, wow. Amazing. How about some undulating rainbows? Oh, wow. And now, a little bit of audio reactive magic synced to some royalty-free music. Now let's turn our attention to the white LED task lighting. Like I mentioned earlier, the main reason I'm upgrading this is for the much higher PWM frequency, which shouldn't interfere with headphones, microphones, or the camera's shutter speeds. Sure, you could build yourself something using an ESP32, some high-speed N-channel FETs, toss in some filtering caps and power supply conditioning, and then 3D print an enclosure. But for the same price, you can buy this really well-built unit made by QuinLED AN. The internet's favorite Dutch ergobled purveyor. This is the AN Penta Plus, a 5-channel, high-current, analog LED lighting controller built exactly for this use case. Each output is fused for safety, and it's all housed in a beautifully thought-out, anodized aluminum enclosure with FR4 circuit boards as the faceplate. It has heavy-duty, removable screw terminal blocks, extra outputs for ergobleds if you want them, and support for I2C. There's a Type-C USB port if you want to reflash it with custom firmware, and a little Wi-Fi antenna, and even an Ethernet port for mission-critical comms. For about $50, it's an incredibly well-built solution. This isn't sponsored or anything, there's not even a link in the description. I just genuinely think it's a smart and well-executed design. Installation is just as straightforward as the others. I'll just temporarily supply 12 volts to the power terminals here. These are seriously overbuilt and can handle far more than the 10 amps I'll be using, which is always nice. Then connect your LED light strips to these output terminals here. For now, I'm only using two of the outputs, and I'll wire in the rest of my lights later. Then I'll power it up and join its access point, same as I did with the other ones. Enter the Wi-Fi credentials and your LED preferences. In my case, I have two channels currently set up on GPIO 32 and 33. I'm going to go down here and set the transition time to 3 seconds. Then I'll turn off the colored LEDs and turn on the new white LEDs. And you can see just how buttery smooth these transitions are. Oh wow, such smooth, very transition, much dimming. Next, I'll mount this up in here with the other controller. So convenient and easily accessible. Next, I'll set up this handy RF remote control. All of these WLED controllers can work with this cheap RF remote using ESP Now. It's surprisingly handy. Just jump into your Wi-Fi settings, scroll down to the bottom, make sure the ESP Now checkmark is checked off, and then click a button. Then, when you go back into Wi-Fi setup again, you'll see this last seen device right here. And you just click on that, it'll copy it into the field, save and connect. And now, all of these WLED controllers will obey the remote control. And now you have a slick little Wi-Fi remote that turns your lights on and off, dims and brightens, as well as triggering 4 of your favorite presets. And any neurotypical person would be perfectly content with that. But I'm going to take this one step further and tie all of this together with some Python. I got the silicon to write me a quick script that first commands a firework starburst on the addressable LEDs before fading in the white LEDs. It's got a bit more punch than just a simple fade. And now, a nice fade to off. Let's try a few more effects here. I've got this script set to randomly cycle through a few effects as a transition. And I'm well aware that many of you are already familiar with WLED, so nothing I've shown here is groundbreaking. And yes, I've glossed over a ton of the features. WLED supports time-based presets, so you can trigger a gentle sunrise at 6 a.m. or cycle through your favorite audio-reactive effects when you're feeling a little extra. These controllers also support button inputs or capacitive sensors, so you could, for example, wire it to an aluminum strip like this and simply tap it to turn your lights off and on. You can even integrate the whole thing into Home Assistant if that's the sort of rabbit hole you're eager to fall into. Now, since I've only just got this all up and running, there's still a lot I don't know, so feel free to roast me down in the comments. Tell me everything I did wrong and what I should have done better. It really helps feed the algorithm. If you're interested in the exact LED strips or controllers that I used, you'll find Amazon links down in the description. And if 3,000 of you click through and buy them, I'll finally break even on this whole endeavor. A Felican dream. A massive thank you to our supporting channel members. Your support makes our travels and these videos possible. Because of you, I don't have to shoehorn a segue into some dubious sponsor. Especially our top tier members, Furious George, Cecil Neville, East of Somewhere, Seam, Austin Space, John S., Aaron Isaac, Frank Brantz, and Gary Rudon. Thank you guys so much. And to everyone else, thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.